This video is brought to you by CuriosityStream. Go to curiositystream.com/polyphonic to get 30 days of membership for free. In the spring of 1977, Jeff Lynne was staying at a remote chalet in the Swiss Alps. He had just wrapped up touring with Electric Light Orchestra in support of their sixth studio album, A New World Record. He already had his eyes on the follow-up, but couldn't find his creativity. The skies were gray and rainy, and Lynne felt completely stifled. Then, after 2 weeks of poor weather, Lynne awoke to a bright sun cresting over the mountains, backed by a blue sky. He was struck with inspiration by the beauty of the moment and set out to capture it in song. What resulted was one of the most iconic songs that Lynne would ever write, and a suite that stands as one of the finest in ELO's career. Let's take a closer look. When the sun came out and Jeff Lynne began to write, he found that he couldn't stop. He wrote nearly all of ELO's next album, Out of the Blue, in just 2 weeks, particularly impressive given that it's a double album. And while it contains many high points, the most enduring to this day may be Mr. Blue Sky. With its relentlessly upbeat cheer, Mr. Blue Sky has become the stuff of legends today, thanks in no small part to its uses in film and TV. But Mr. Blue Sky isn't just a standalone track, it's the final movement in a bigger piece called Concerto for a Rainy Day. Taking up the entire third side of Out of the Blue, that suite explores the ways that weather impacts our moods and emotions. It opens on the desperate standing in the rain and recordings of a thunderstorm that sat atop ELO as they were recording Out of the Blue in Munich. From the very beginning, we get to see some of ELO's signatures. One of the most important aspects of ELO is their symphonic rock. In the late 1960s, groups like the Beach Boys and the Beatles brought ambitious orchestration into their pop and rock music. Songs like A Day in the Life used multiple movements and a live orchestra to build drama and tension. ELO got their start in the 70s and picked up this baton where the Beatles left off. But it wasn't just the Beatles, ELO really tried to pull from classical music too. Just look at the song titles on their debut album. With an overture and a song called First Movement, it's clear that they're trying to meld classical song forms with popular music. This is reflected in Standin' in the Rain. After the atmospheric intro, we get a swell of strings, intercut with a staccato portion that spells out ELO in Morse code. Those strings carry us through most of Standin' in the Rain. They paint a dramatic picture for 2 full minutes before we get vocals. Even then, the lyrics are simple and seem to take a back seat to the instrumentals. At its conclusion, Standin' in the Rain calms down, and we get to see one of ELO's favorite tools, the vocoder. Vocoders are a technology that digitally encode the human voice. In the context of music, this means that it can be run through synthesizers to create a unique, robotic sound. In this situation, it sets up a lull that falls over our music as we push to the second movement. Big wheels. The clouds are now pouring a calmer, miserable rain rather than a violent one. This is the lyrical low point of the suite, in which the narrator reflects on depression and loneliness. And grow they do. The song begins small, but by the time we're 4 minutes in, we've reached a dramatic climax with cascading string lines. Just at the moment of despair, we cut to the budding optimism of Summer and Lightning. Our narrator has realized that even in the worst of storms, there's hope to be found. This is reflected in a bright, optimistic chorus and jangly guitar. While there's still tension in the orchestra, the song breaks into pure freedom 2.5 minutes in. It momentarily turns from a dramatic orchestral piece into a simple, fun jam. When the strings come back, they're playful, jumping around with the instruments. The cry of "Here it comes again" becomes a mantra of sorts, driving forward into a hopeful future. And then we get to the legendary moment. Everything falls to a calm, and the sun emerges, and with it, Mr. Blue Sky. To this day, Mr. Blue Sky is acclaimed as one of the brightest, most relentlessly optimistic songs ever written. That's why it's a staple in countless films, either as a sign of a joyful mood or as a comedic foil to undercut the seriousness of a situation. But I think that the positivity of the song is made that much more powerful when you've listened to the preceding context, when you can reflect on the desperation of standing in the rain, the desolation of Big Wheels. The contrast is that much more powerful. To create this joy, ELO looked at some of their biggest influences, particularly the Beatles. The intro to Mr. Blue Sky is a clear homage to the middle section of the Beatles' epic A Day in the Life. Both open on similar piano parts, and both narrate the start of a day. In case that's not enough, ELO even use a vocal sample of someone panting in homage to the Beatles' sound design. The sound design in the opening verse is also reminiscent of Penny Lane with a dinging bell. ELO actually created their bell sound by drumming on a fire extinguisher. Mr. Blue Sky's chorus even seems to have shades of the Beach Boys in the vocal harmonizations and the barbershop quartet feel. And while Mr. Blue Sky would stand up fine as a fantastic pastiche of some of the best moments of psychedelic pop, that's not all it is. It's also representative of many of ELO's own strengths, notably their arrangement. An unexpected guitar solo comes in after the first chorus, just a minute into the song's 5-minute runtime. As we progress, we see ELO's classical influences showing up. The song walks through several movements, introducing new themes and playing around with them. And of course, we have the iconic vocoder breakdown in the middle. All of this builds together with a fantastic choral movement that would appear to be the last of the song, and for most artists, it would have been. But for ELO, Mr. Blue Sky was the last movement of a suite, and so it needed to go off with a suitable climax. So the last minute of Mr. Blue Sky shifts into a different kind of finale, looking back and citing the rest of the suite, then building to a final calm and satisfying resolution, followed by a vocoded voice telling you to turn your record over. Mr. Blue Sky is the culmination of a brilliant concerto that displays the versatility and genius of ELO. And its story teaches us that if you're feeling down, if you're in a creative slump, if all you see are gray skies, sometimes you just need to persevere and wait for the sun. Hey you! If you're watching this video, you're probably a fan of music and probably like learning more about it, so why don't you check out the documentary The Jazz Loft According to W. Eugene Smith on CuriosityStream. It's a documentary that honestly left me floored watching it. Using archival photos from Smith, it paints an intimate picture of a moment in jazz history. And there's lots more when you finish that. CuriosityStream is the first subscription streaming service dedicated to documentary content. Created by the guy who started the Discovery Channel, CuriosityStream has more than 2,400 documentary titles on all kinds of topics. If you want something neat, why not check out The Science of Bubbles, which taught me that there's way more to bubbles than I ever considered. If you go to curiositystream.com/polyphonic and enter the code polyphonic, you can check out these fantastic documentaries completely free. That code will give you your first 30 days free, and after that, membership is just $2.99 a month. Honestly, CuriosityStream is a really cool platform, and I really like putting my name behind it. So please go check it out, and remember to use my link and the coupon code to let them know that I sent you.